This is Apocalypse X back with another 4K Little video. My friend invited me to play some Magic with him, and he is usually a Miracles player, but he also plays 4K alone and sometimes just messes around. So the Magic could be whatever. Most likely Miracles.
Your game has started.
So we can, if we keep its Grove into Green Sun, hope for no disruption, play a Selwyn Library if we miss a land drop. That's not great. We're gonna mulligan this. Opponent's making fun of me for my slow play. We're gonna keep this because it has a removal spell and that thing, and this thing's kind of too weak in the early game. Right. This is very likely Miracles, which means that these cards are pretty good in the matchup. Might be a counterbalance here. It's a little unfortunate that Festering Sage doesn't tap for colors, but we can very likely sneak Sylvan Library through, and then that'll help us find our second colored mana source to cast the Abrupt Decay, then to cast a Knight and maybe combo him. Okay, there was a line where we could have got a Deathrite Shaman. Then we have the option next turn to play a Knight regardless of whether or not we make a land drop. We have the option to for sure Abrupt Decay this counterbalance. And then if we draw another land, we can also maybe Punishing Fire something that he plays. Unlikely as it is to happen. So here we're sort of forced to cast this Green Sun for either 0 or 1. There's less 2 drops in the deck, so I'm just tapping out for it. And okay, that's really bad for us. These are the kinds of games that we can very easily lose. Yeah, our chances to win are minute here. We can get a white source. We can maybe play a knight, force our opponent to bounce it. Yeah, I think that's what happens if we draw fetch. Did not draw a fetch. I mean, this is a losing game, but we're going to play a couple more turns of it. Okay, I guess we're not playing a couple more turns of it. Well, if Jace doesn't bounce the Deathrite Shaman, if he's sort of too sure of himself, we maybe have a chance with Decayed Angel. Ugh. Okay, I mean, I have to try. If I wasn't recording this, there's a pretty small chance I'd continue playing this game. There's almost no chance that he's gonna mess up or that there's like some horrible weakness that he's hiding. Yeah, there's no point playing more of this game. All right, so the way that I board for Miracles generally is Dismember doesn't have enough use. Deathrite Shaman is, first of all, bad with Chalice, and this is a game where card advantage does matter. Speed isn't super important, and also I don't want to commit more creatures than I need to. I shave one Punishing Fire in case my opponent boards into a heavy creature strategy. I bring Rexage because there's a bunch of naturalizables I board in, Thalia because she taxes everything they do with their pretty slow deck. Maelstrom Pulse is a catch-all for like Jace and stuff. Phyrexian Revoker is also named top in Jace. And then Choke can be potentially game-ending. We take out one Mox Diamond. We don't want to take out two because of the threat of Blood Moon. We take out Scavenging Ooze because it's always just a bear. They like sometimes like Snapcaster, but that's not enough utility. We take out one Life Moon because they often board in Rest in Peace, and we want to blank that. And now we want to cut one more card. We don't necessarily need to bring in Maelstrom Pulse, but I like it as just an extra Abrupt Decay. We could cut Dryad Arbor, but it's a pretty good card on turn one. We can sort of agree that we're just not going to do that play because it makes us weaker to their strengths, and we don't need to be super fast. So let's just go ahead and do that. Your game has started. As you can see, the sideboarding is in a little bit of flux, depending on what exactly is in the board. So this is a Grove and a Tranquil Thicket. Have two draw steps to draw, hopefully a black source. But the payoff's not amazing here. We could have also cut another Lobe. Just because we can't wasteland them that hard. The Tranquil Thicket punishing Tranquil Thicket Grove engine is more of a late game thing where we're sort of committing to winning the early game. This we're keeping because it has Chalice and Athalia, which are both great. We don't need Knight number three. Interesting. Leading with Plains. I'm just going to go ahead and turn off all the ones. If this resolves, we're in great shape. Even though the hand like doesn't look particularly amazing. So here, there's no use naming Todd with Revoker, and he's nowhere near Chase mana, so I'm going to run out Thalia. I kind of don't like showing him second wasteland, because that tells him that we're like having problems with colored mana, but we can potentially be very punished for not playing our lands at the correct time. So here the chances of my opponent flipping a Blind Theory are pretty small. I'm just going to go ahead and play a Knight. Alright, that's a wastelandable. Huh. Okay, well, there's a threat. We're in a pretty bad spot right now. So we can definitely attack if we want to. We don't have two valid lands to Knight away, so there's no point, so it's not safe going for the combo. So we're just going to try to reduce our opponent's life total. They're probably going to run cantrips into Chalice in order to get tokens, but it's going to cost them two mana per cantrip. So this is still okay for us. Opponent had a fetch, but instead chose to play a Tundra, which lets us wasteland them again, which lets us keep them off of Jace. Which means we can hold this for a little bit longer, if we want to. So, Windswept Heath gives us access to the combo. But also, we can wasteland, then cast Mox Diamond, putting two lands in the yard, making these attack for 10 total. I kind of like that more. Okay. See, I would have thought I was sort of overly cautious not attacking with Thalia, but now I'm rewarded for. Now I don't have to feel bad for not attacking with Thalia. So there's no chance of Jace, so I don't need to play this Roker. There's no chance of top. So again, that's not necessary. I'm trying to think of other things that are commonly played that I would want to revoke now, and there's like that blue-red pinger. But yeah, this is something we anticipated that things can become a 4-4. You can double block. I'll kill your Monastery Munter. I'm okay with that trade. So I'm just gonna keep this in my hand. So maybe there's a temptation to like run this thing out to be more mana efficient, but we also want to encourage our opponent to play towards a game plan, which is not feasible. There's three cards in their hand, so they could potentially play two cards to eat Thalia, but we're gonna attack into it anyway. The alternative to attacking is we can go for Mirror Lage now. I kind of like attacking normally. It's weaker to them having random creatures. And I guess we're sort of, this line is, in general, is weaker to Vendilion Click. So maybe it's not correct. If he double blocks and then plays a spell, who's down to two cards in hand. I think I'm okay with this. Yeah, because that mean that he goes to five life. So we're very unhappy if. There's a Terminus. But I think we'd be unhappy anyway, because this is not much of a force to be sort of keeping back. And there's absolutely no manipulation that our opponent has done. This is one of the reasons why we would like to attack instead of holding this up. So we couldn't go for the combo if they have a Blood Moon. But we could just try to attack them down. And we did have one Maw, so we could cast spells through Blood Moon. Cast some large percentage of our spells. With three Green Sun Zenith, it becomes less bad to be mooned down to one green source. It doesn't necessarily turn off all the green white creatures in the deck. That's a pretty good position. We're going to pay 4 life just to see 2 new cards next turn, on the off chance that our opponent has something here. All right. Now, if he bounces Mox, is it even that bad for us? I mean, it's pretty bad that there's a high chance that there's a land on top. Okay. Right, so we are fine here. We can't cast this, but we can cast this.
Started.
It's actually a really interesting hand. So on one hand, there's no acceleration, which we sort of caused by taking out a lot of our turn one acceleration. There's only three cards that do that for us, so we can't count that against this hand, and we shouldn't because this is miracles. Then we have turn two library, turn three knight, which is pretty strong. My opponent's very excited to lose this game. It seems like it'll be way more of a game than the last one. So because we have the luxury of fetching three times, we can get a basic with at least one of these. We also sort of want to calculate into our fetching. How we can best capitalize by drawing a Mox, because we don't want to throw away the dark types of the Mox if we can resolve a knight. Which means that I'm not, well, I'm certainly not fetching at a turn, but I'm, oh, okay, that's more lands than I thought we'd get. So now we can fetch for Bayou Forest. Because next turn is as soon as they could have had a Blood Moon. Unfortunately, Choke sort of saves his Volcanic Island. Blood Moon saves his Volcanic Island from Choke. Battle of the of Legacy's best card selection tools. Guess best non-blue card selection tools. This is to be expected. Our opponent really can't let us resolve that card because it represents like three bonus cards if they don't put pressure on us. Maybe more, depending on if they like Swords of Flash or stuff. This sounds like a smells like a Blood Moon. Okay, sweet. So here we're choking. We're choking because our opponent only gets one random look to see a three on top. And this resolving is way more important than anything else, and there's also two tapped lands. This is double sinkhole right now. Sweet. That is excellent for us. So now, let's go ahead and try to resolve a knight. If this resolves, we're playing Windswept Heath and passing, because there's no point playing the Dark Depths and letting them know that knight needs to be removed as soon as possible. I'm perfectly happy with my opponent being under the illusion that they have one more turn to plow it or whatever. And there's no use wastelanding this while Choke is in play. Okay. On the bright side, they tapped them out. So now I can... I'm going to fetch out a Dryad Arbor to have a permanent source of damage in play. Did we take out Dryad Arbor? We took out Dryad Arbor. I feel dumb. I'm going to get a Plateau. Just going to get back the Knight. There's some argument that we maybe want to break up these guys, but as long as we can keep casting cards that don't care about it, and they clearly don't have a shuffle effect, and there hasn't been a 3, then it's probably fine. Now, if our opponent plays like Fetch Land, Swords of Plowshares, your Knight, we're probably in a bad spot, because now we're trying to resolve Yaddak Teeg through countertop. But we also haven't drawn any of our... There's 9 cards that break this up in our deck. I don't think there's anything they can do to stop this. Meaning any pinpoint removal targeting Knight won't stop it. Sweet. All right, well, my opponent wanted a rematch. it wasn't a particularly close game. It was defined by several blowouts, so I think that's perfectly fair to do some more testing. Our lands don't cast our spells here, so we're going to mulligan that. This I don't like, because our threat has to be a 1-drop, but I also don't want to go to 5. I'm going to go to 5. It's better. No. We already have sufficient lands to cast the spells in our hand, and we would prefer a 2-drop. So the reason we mulligan that 6 is there's not a ton of... There aren't 2 colored mana sources there. Ooh. So... Our opponent led with a non-basic, which means that they might not have any better lands in their hand. But they also ponder, which increases the probability that they do. So we're just going to play for Catacombs and pass. Wasteland on turn 1 is often a very high variance play, because it takes you guys equally away from your goal, except the person who's going the turn after that is on the play again, and they might have a better turn 1 than they did the last time they got a turn 1. So if they if there's a top on top of their deck, and a fetch in hand, or a vice versa, you're just actively making the situation work for yourself. But if, you know, if they hadn't pondered, maybe there's an argument to do that. We need to buy you and not play around Blood Moon because this is game 1. So given that we multiplied this game, we are not favored at all. But our opponent hasn't really done anything yet. This might be a counterspell. It's a counterspell. Okay, let's see if they have the follow-up Jace to make us feel really bad about our life decisions. Our life decisions being drawing a bad 7 and then possibly correctly mulliganing a wonky 6. I mean, it had Deathrite Shaman as a threat. That's the last thing you want. You want an actual threat if that's the only threat in your hand. And, you know, Wastelands alone don't interact sufficiently with Miracles. And, you know, Dismember is... It's a playable card, but it's not very good. It's entirely possible that there won't be any targets for it. And the targets are often, like, Snapcasters for a large percentage of the game. There's only 1 green source, unfortunately, so what we're going to do is Wasteland, a mana source, and play a Knight. Our opponent is thinking about this play for longer than I would have anticipated. Okay. Yep, so it is expected. This is again a little unfortunate because we have to cast the green spell here because it's insane, but they get to potentially counter it, and also we don't get the cycle, so this land is stuck in our hand. My hopes for this card resolving are not very high. If it does resolve, then we're in an excellent spot. Okay, so it's getting forced. It's What's happening here? My opponent knows the top three cards. They could have rearranged differently than just drawn the first. So I'm not sure what they're looking for. Maybe they had forced blue card at the bottom two cards, and they needed both because they didn't have a blue card. Oh, whoops. I'm dumb. They're setting up counterbalance. Okay. Makes perfect sense now. It's a little late here. So I'm not at the top of my game. Alright, well, if it worked last turn. And we're at 4 mana, we have all of our colors, so we don't want to play this Tranquil if they get tapped, and it's worth way more to us, just as a thing we can cycle. There's a counterbalance on top, so we know it's in their hand now. So they have to find another two, and it took them all these gymnastics in order to put it on top there in the first place. So I'm optimistic about this card resolving. Okay, so the bottommost card was a counterspell. And now we are in a lot of trouble. So, we're not going to show our opponent anything to sort of bluff that we're saving up content to overload counterbalance slash counterspell. Whereas in reality, we are hoping that they tap out for something that doesn't matter and don't hold up double blue so that we can draw a card that is live right now and get back into this game. These are fairly slim odds. So now we can actually, let's wait one more turn, try to draw a piece of action, and maybe resolve one of the two cards. It's really good. But at the same time, now they only have one mana cost that they're able to turn off. It's probably going to be two. So if we draw a knight right now, we're dead. This boarding a Dryad Arbor feels kind of unnatural to me. I rarely boarded out it. This is something that's that I'm trying now. Which is partly why I was why I made the mistake in the previous match. Choke, Maelstrom Pulse, Revokers, Rex Sage, Alias. Oh, and Mox Diamond's out. So there's the argument of do we want out to remove another Life from Loam for Dryad Arbor to turn on the Green Sensei? I kind of actually really like having Dryad Arbor, even if it's bad to have multiple creatures. We saw in Beta Mentor last time, so I mean the card in my mind is like kind of terrifying and oppressive, but in practice it might just not be. We could cut a Green Sensei, then that makes us a lot weaker against Blood Moon and the like. I'm gonna cut this Maelstrom Pulse for the Dryad Arbor. This is my more normal configuration. We'll keep this. We'll be. So we can almost definitely cast Choke. We can definitely cast Chalice. We're screwed off of all our colors, though. I feel like this is the kind of hand we can be keeping against Miracles. Against the Delver, for example, this would be an auto mulligan, just because we can't cast our early upper decays. So after turn, Two, we don't have a game plan. But Miracles is slow enough that we can fumble a little bit. And they won't immediately punish us for it. Like here, if my opponent forces this chalice, we can just play another chalice. Regardless of whether or not the opponent forces the chalice, we can just play a second chalice. And we won't be super behind. But we're actually in a bad spot if we don't draw land next turn. Drawing a land in our top three cards is pretty likely. So that's I'm comfortable making that bet almost always. This is nice. The card actually didn't do anything because of our excess chalices. Land, 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 land. It's a little frustrating. And this is the sort of stuff that I talk about on and off. Since we're below on mana, we can't wasteland them, and they're allowed to do this kind of stuff unpunished. I guess I'll play another chalice. They're not going on any other number in this matchup, so the alternative is, like, I can wasteland them and make my situation worse, or I can just keep them in my hand. So if my opponent taps out making monks, we can choke him, then play, like, a knight or a decay, assuming we ever draw lands. Interesting. Okay. That brainstorm was double countered. Okay. Yeah, we're throwing away this basic because we want to be able to cast spells. And now we have a lot of options. I think I like casting choke. It's like the most harmful thing we can be doing right now. Our opponent does have counterspell mana up, which might be a consideration. So they're just deciding to race with brainstorms as pump spells. This is sort of an argument for keeping in Maelstrom Pulse. Yep. So our opponent's like incredibly vulnerable now. There's one land in the graveyard. This is a 3-3. I'm not willing to trade it if our opponent finds a pump spell. So we're just going to start slowly decaying his permanence. And he's all in on this game plan. And the contents of our hand answers the game plan. So we're in a pretty good spot despite almost losing the game to not drawing a third mana source in four turns, three turns. So I'm going to play out Yarok Teeg and Tranquil Thicket. And Yarok Teeg will eat one. If there's no pump, and if there is a pump, it'll trade for one. Which is fine as well. And then we want to establish Thicket because we might want to play Knight and keep up Wasteland for pump on the off chance that our opponent in the next two turns plays like mana sources and might be able to trade for the Knight. We can play it slightly safer and not attack with Yarok Teeg. There isn't much of an incentive to do so anyway. Alright. Okay, I'm gonna do the thing that feels a little bit more wrong, but should be a little bit more right. Against some decks, I would keep this. This is potentially action, and we have enough acceleration that these wastelands are pretty potent. But against Miracles, I'm not going to, because this can very easily brick, and then we don't have action. And if it's one of their better draws, We're in a bad spot. We're gonna keep this on the bottom of this fourth chalice. So these kinds of hands, they look pretty bad on paper, but this is the counterbalance. But resolving a chalice is a pretty big deal in the matchup, and our opponent has brought in cards specifically to blow up our chalices. So even if we don't draw threats for a little while, you just play a second chalice. The third chalice is undesirable. That's pretty cool. Getting a basic player on Blood Moon. There isn't a huge reason for playing out the stage first, but actually, yeah, there's, I mean, the any reason there is like minimal. If your opponent's like not very good or maybe very tired, they might forget sort of the acknowledgement of a stage being played was a turn ago, so they might not be sort of on their radar when they play Dark Depths, but it's quite unlikely that a real opponent would behave like that. But I mean, these edges do matter against some people. There are also situations where maybe there's like a really good land you want to play. If you draw Stirring Wildwood, that's something you want to get into play sooner rather than later, so it might mess with your sequencing, and then you will have to choose between Thespian Stage and Dark Depths on time versus the mainland. It's probably a more relevant concern, but like all this stuff is sort of a gut feel, and it's a little bit difficult to describe exactly why certain choices are being made. I'm going to see if our opponent wants to trade with us. That would be great, because otherwise they form this sort of 4-mana Maze of Ith against our Mirror Lage. And, yeah, I actually really don't like the fact that that exists. So much so that I'm considering not playing Dark Depths. Yeah, okay, I've been convinced not to play Dark Depths. I'm gonna wait till we draw a Wasteland or our opponent does something else. We probably shouldn't have played the Plateau before playing Chalice. Our opponent bottomed a Force of Will. That was kind of weird. When we kind of mess in their hand. Sure. I don't really understand this play at all. Okay, so now, I was saying now if our opponent does that in combat and targets themselves, we might get them to trade the click, but it's very likely, yeah, okay, we're being targeted, our opponent is not, is going to let us keep the chalice, but then he's going to realize how important the click is here, so we're going to get to attack for free with Bob. And because our opponent has this easy answer to Dark Depths, we're incentivized to not activate it. There's no reason not to play it because they know about it. Life alone would only get two fetch lands, which is not very good right now. So instead, I'm going to play a knight. Now, our opponent hasn't done any manipulation of the top of the deck at all. So we're just going to go ahead and jam this knight. Maybe we should have. Well, our opponent has both cards, so there's no point. Oh, I'm also dumb. Caracas bounces Dark Depths. It's very rarely a concern, because most of the time I make Dark Depth, Marital Age off of either Reliquary, and then I can just make one more pit stop and get a Wasteland. But that is a reason why we shouldn't have been going for these things. I guess, like, somewhere in the back of my head I sort of understand this, but it doesn't, so I come to the conclusion of, like, I don't want to do this, but I don't necessarily know why. I'm going to activate Knight, Wasteland my opponent off of their Caracas, and then attack for two and see if they can beat. They don't have a white source. They're probably going to get one last activation out of this. Yep. So the click is valuable because it buys the opponent one turn against Dark Steps, so I don't think they're going to trade it for a Bob. But they're welcome too. That decreases. Okay. It's fine. That decreases the number of creatures that get hurt by Terminus here. Sort of. Yeah, I'm on this plan. The alternative would be to get the Gat of Teak and prevent the Terminus, but it's blind. Sweet. Did not think I was going to win that one. So, we're playing one more match with a slightly different sideboarding strategy on my opponent's part. This hand's insane, so we're keeping it. I talked to my opponent briefly, and he was wondering what kinds of cards he should be signing out. In my opinion, sort of the Miracles deck's versatility is its biggest strength. I sort of need to have a game plan for an answer for whatever game plan the Miracles deck might be on. And there's a lot of things they could be doing. They could be playing sort of a tempo deck with Mentors. They could be playing, Hard Control. They could be playing sort of a Prison thing with Counterbalance and Blood Moon. There's a ton of single cards that are very high impact that I have to play around, specifically Blood Moon being one of them. Sometimes people can bring in Moat. I have two Naturalized effects, and like sometimes a Maelstrom Pulse, but and Merit Mage especially. But sometimes you get caught off guard by this sort of stuff. And then there's just a lot of pieces to be sort of playing around. This sucks for us. One. So I ended up suggesting my opponent try taking out counterbalances, because in, at least in these games, and sort of in general, they only punish a small subset of my draws. And I think he's going to be good against basically whatever you do. Ish. I mean, you're not going to blink it, is my argument. But at the same time, the card's like not all that great without a top. And even with, I've been able to, navigate all my Green Sun's units and neither Reliquaries past it. We decided not to dredge because the way that I play this game, specifically without Liliana's, we're sort of the aggressor. Not that we can't win a long game, but it's a lot easier for us to win a short game. So now, what we could do is Abrupt Decay the counterbalance. Make a mana with neither Reliquary, put another land in the graveyard. But there's nothing in the graveyard right now, so we kind of don't want to loam. Now here's an interesting question. I think we play out the Bayou and forego sort of a knight aggro plan, because that is worse against swords and other cards. And instead, we play a second knight and allow the first knight to fetch up a Thespian Stage. both pumping up the both knights and bring us one turn closer to a combo kill, which is harder to disrupt, specifically with ground creatures like Snapcaster. What is it in my opponent's graveyard? Okay, there's a brainstorm. I was wondering if it was just sort of a 2-2. The Ambush Viper. So we're going to keep by because it's the green source, and we generally want as many green sources as we can get. And we could take them off red, but there's not a lot of important red spells. We could sort of prevent Mana Flood with Horizon Academy. We could get Grove to kill the Snapcaster Mage, but that's also not super important. Instead, we are getting a Stirring Wildwood because we want a threat. So we committed into this Terminus because there was the expectation of a blind Terminus, and then our opponent played a Snapcaster at our end step, which I would say it's not necessarily incorrect to do what we did. Also, that was only a 2-for-1. And we're sort of even on cards. In reality, my opponent's got probably 2 cards, but it's not a huge deal right now. So if we loam into like 2 random cards, we're in a pretty good spot. 2 random lands. Except if this counterbalance is a 2 on top. Let's go ahead and loam. I don't do this all that often, because generally your like random loams don't give you cards that you want to loan back, but here I'm actually fine establishing any sort of mana base. So we're going to blow this up because we're casting a 2-drop, which is rather easy to flip off of counterbalance. Not the easiest, but he did brainstorm, so I'm willing to bet that's possible for this to get countered. Wasteland, Grove. We're in Catacombs, even though it's not going to matter. Oops. Okay, that's fine. I mean, there's our opponent has all their colors anyway. I would prefer to play at the Wasteland and maybe waste them, but it's not a big deal. I feel kind of dumb if my opponent has like a second counterbalance right now. So we could have theoretically taken them off of it. They chose not to shuffle. We're going to go ahead and kill this thing. Pre-board, there's not a ton of good targets for Punishing Fire, and we can always bring it back. So we're going to choose not to dredge because there's anything in here we particularly want. This is probably getting exiled. This sort of means we 2-for-2'd with Terminus and our knights. And now they're on a higher life total than I would like them to be. But we do have a Punishing Fire loop going. Next turn, I might dredge alone just to put a 1 land down, especially if they don't make a land drop. Taking a lot of juice mana would be nice. Yeah, this prepares us for a longer game. They have 5 mana. I kind of don't want to dredge. I mean, we could draw bad cards, and that's a risk, but Wasteland is not a particularly good card either, and like Verdant Catacombs gets nothing special either. All right, well, we have some sort of clock. So here, then we're not under pressure to really do much, and we know there isn't that 2 on top. So we're gonna go ahead and play this out. Okay, yeah, our opponent has correctly taken some damage off of punishing fires because they're not important to counter. But this guy is, so that's what's happening right now. Might be a long game. So here I'm going to go ahead and get a knight. Cancel. Sweet. This guy opponent has just found a 2-drop. I wish I could click over to see the graveyard to see whether or not they still have swords. I'm gonna go ahead and assume that there is a swords in there because I think they've cast one. So I'm going to get Pride Mage, because we don't necessarily need more win cons than these guys. We need to protect our established win cons. Yeah, okay, there's a sword, so my... this is like a pretty large mistake. Try to ponder. Sure. I'm not going to Punishing Fire at end of turn if our opponent has a card in their hand, because I really don't want to get this Crystallite Pyre Mage Cloud. It's pretty harmless to play around that. Right, okay, so we are rewarded for not being greedy. Let's blow up counterbalance, paying 1 mana. Then I'm going to save all the Punishing Fire action for their turn. Unless of course we want to kill Snapcaster now. Yeah, let's kill Snapcaster now. This is sort of a grindy control mirror at this point. Yeah. Okay, so this Granny Control Mirror comment was to sort of, they might have interaction, and, you know, it was actually this wrong. Sure, our opponent is brainstorming knowing that they can't keep Chase alive in the face of double punishing fire. So at the end step, we're gonna get out a dried arbor and continue the beats. It's really odd how our opponent seemed to have like two or three cards. And then sort of while we were dawdling with Punishing Fire, they disappeared. Probably went into this massive land base. Oh, sweet. Let's do this. We're top deck mode. They have a ton of cards in their deck that cost one mana. We misstepped a little bit, so we can't like kill an X4. Depending on like what's in the deck, that might matter. Unlikely though. No real reason to play at the Savannah that I can think of. I mean, the reason might be that we can like start dredging loam and just loaming every turn to find cycle lands and stuff, but I think that's unnecessary at this point. And our sequencing is sort of not super tight. But I don't think it matters. Targeting Force of Will. Yeah, that's fine. Maybe it was incorrect to get him for that one damage, but I also kind of don't want to expose this knight to anything. I don't think it matters. We're just super in control of this game. Think we just throw these upstairs and hit him for one. Okay, if you want to play a long game, we can play a long game. I'm gonna kill Chase now. Well, no, it's not. So, same as last time for the not controversial slots. Then we're gonna stare at these two guys again. And then decide to do the seemingly more correct play. This is great. So let's get a forest to play around Blood Moon. So we have the option to keep up Abrupt Decay for maybe Blood Moon, maybe whatever else, but Blood Moon's like not a 4 of, and our opponent hasn't played any cantrips. So I'm going to turn off a larger, I'm going to sort of make worse a larger percentage of their deck. Okay. So they're able to take away our threat slash Earth Engine, if that's desirable. Okay. That's not great news for us. So let's decay this thing first and ask questions later. The questions being, should I play Thalia or Bob? The answer being Bob. They both want to be on board as fast as possible. But we only have two spells left in our hand. So I'm kind of biased towards finding more playables. It's also more likely to find an answer to a click that isn't just Caracas. Okay. That's scary. Hindsight, I think we were better off leaving Upstart and Wildwood to blank both of these guys. I'm gonna play Revoker on Jace here. Because we don't have a, we can't take him off 5 mana. Yeah, so like this, this is a line where they could have top and have it be good. But I was thinking, you know, this is a 2 of at most. Jace is also a 2 of at most, but they need to have this plus top in order to get top active. I'm going to bounce this to not take 3 damage. If it'll let me. Maybe I skip through that. It kind of sucks, giving up some amount of value. Okay, now I have to choose between letting my Thalia get killed and that knight. I don't think Thalia is that important. My opponent is 5 mana. So I'm going to respond by bouncing this legend. We're not in a great spot. Actually, we're in a fine spot. So if this sort of is everything my opponent has, then we're fine. So Farpen has two spells. This gets eaten, but we sort of have to take that chance. I'm going to block here to preserve my net total a little bit. So that's the way to win the game. Okay. Yep. It's relatively, harmless to cycle this. We're sort of forced to bounce Vendilion Click, block here. We'd still be taking two if we don't play a creature, which we are going to play a creature. If the opponent doesn't have another spell, we can sort of get them with our Dryad Arbor. This is really not looking good here. Yep, we're not Dryad Arbor. Okay, so I killed myself. That was pretty unfortunate. It's probably still more correct to have in Tales from Bowls, but I should really remember that what I changed the way that this works. Yeah, that only has one spell in it. This is good. We don't need multiples of that card. Mostly because we'll need to shut off the top and such. So I kind of want to get a black source, but I also want to play around Blood Moon. I'm going to get a black source instead. So I'm going to wait on Revoker, because our opponent doesn't have a top. Sure, that's overall pretty good for us. It's great for us. So we take them off a mana source. We're taking them off two mana source so they can play one drops now. And we get to establish our own Sylvan Library, and given that we're the aggressor and we have a very healthy life total, we can just start drawing two cards a turn if they're good. Dog is getting plowed. Oh, okay. But if we keep sort of trading one for one like this, that's in our favor. It's two damage every time. I'm going to play this on top. There are three lands away from Jace. Yeah, that's pretty bad. Sweet. Yeah, we're going to go ahead and get Knight. There's some argument for getting a Teeg, but our opponent is nowhere close to 4 mana. This is a 2-turn clock, probably. Planned or unplanned. Yep. So, attacking twice? Well, this didn't get swords, so yeah, let's just attack twice. The odds of drawing a fetch land or a cycle land are like fairly high. There's four fetches, three wastelands, two cycle lands. What else goes to the graveyard? This Strand is also sort of shut off. Unless Force My Opponent has a blocker, which it looks like they do. It's actually a blocker. If I had to sort of make bold claims, my Miracles matchup is probably worse than Kronberger's matchup, but I don't think it's worse enough that it's something to be particularly concerned about. And especially if you play in this way where you sort of try to play around the maximum number of cards at all times, and you're sort of aware of the one of the your opponent could potentially playing, I think the matchup is perfectly fine. Right, perfectly fine, I mean 70% positive, something like that. Not something to be concerned about at all. Despite the objectively weaker like lack of planeswalkers in the sideboard, lack of planeswalkers in the mainboard. I wonder what this is. Okay. Another blocker. Another jump blocker. Welp. Alright, well, that's the Miracles matchup.